Welcome everybody to continuation of our series on prayer. What are we doing? An excellent question. And tonight, to help us understand what are we doing, we have the honor of having Professor Eitan Fishbane, who serves on the faculty of the Jewish Theological Seminary, where he teaches students in the rabbinical, graduate, and undergraduate schools. Professor Fishbane is a scholar of Jewish mysticism and spirituality. He has authored 3 books and edited 2 others, the recipient of many awards and honors, and he's taught at many synagogues across North America. We're delighted to have him with us this evening. Thank you, and looking forward to the presentation.
Thank you, Rabbi Silver. Thank you to all of you. Wonderful, really special to be here and to be a part of this this really special series and on such a deep and important topic. And I hope that what we'll have to talk about together tonight will also enrich your own religious life, your own prayer life in particular, and that you'll be able to take some new insights with you both into your tefillah life and into the upcoming holiday. So I wanted to open with a little reflecting together a bit on the whole idea of kavanah, of intention in the practice of mitzvot in general and in the practice and performance of tefillah, of prayer in particular, building really upon the classical question that was asked already in rabbinic times, which is to say, can a person fulfill their religious obligation with regard to a mitzvah without kavanah, right? Do the mitzvot need kavanah in order to be fulfilled properly? And there are different opinions on this, and halachic experts here and elsewhere can reflect on that more deeply than I can. But what I'd like to open up for us is the way in which that question is taken in a powerful new direction already in medieval Judaism, particularly in the case of the Rambam, in the case of Moses Maimonides, in his Hilchot Tefillah, his Laws of Prayer, and then how that whole question of intentionality and the centrality of Kavanah in the practice of the mitzvot in general, but more specifically with regard to Tefillah, becomes a centerpiece for how the Jewish mystics, for how the Kabbalists, and then subsequently the Hasidim in later times, which will be our focus tonight, center in on this question. So already the Rambam offers a very different opinion than the consensus opinion in the Gemara, where he asserts that if a person does not perform tefillah, does not recite tefillah with kavanah, then the religious obligation has not been fulfilled. And the Rambam describes the act of kavanah as one of envisioning that the divine presence is standing before a person, that the Shekhinah omedet lifnei ha'adam. So the question being that the intention for tefillah, the intention for prayer, becomes a deeply central dimension of whether the mitzvah itself is performed correctly. And this becomes really quite central for Kabbalah as it emerges in medieval times, such that in order to have performed tefillah, in order to have prayed effectively and fully in the view of these mystics, one has to accompany one's words and the recitation of the liturgy of prayer with a very specific state of mind and a very specific kind of kavanah. And I want to reflect a little bit on this and look at one example of this from medieval Kabbalah to kind of see what comes before some of the other more psychologically based insights and types of meditative reflections that we see attributed to the Baal Shem Tov and early Hasidism. So already in the classic period of medieval Kabbalah, in the writings of Rabbi Yitzchak de Minako, Isaac of Akko, a turn of the 14th century Kabbalist who was known for his descriptions of his mystical experiences and reflections on the meaning of prayer. Rabbi Yitzchak builds upon and transforms a statement that we find already in the Gemara, which it takes it in a very different way. And that classic statement is that a person should always enter shnei ptachim, should enter two openings before beginning to pray. And the question of what that means in its original context is somewhat debated. Many people say that that's a person needs to enter a certain distance into the synagogue before beginning to pray. But for the medieval Kabbalist, for the mystic, this becomes a contemplative, meditative instruction. Which is to say that before you can begin to pray in a deep and powerful way, before you can enter into tefillah in its fullest sense, you need to enter two openings, whatever that might mean. And what it means for the Kabbalist is that the meditative mind of the person, the meditative mind of the mystic engaged in this mystical prayer, needs to ascend upward into the divine world in their mind and enter into dimensions of God. That is to say that God is understood to be a series of gates within gates, of openings within openings, ptachim, and that the mind is charged with the task of a kind of pilgrimage to the upper world, a kind of journey of the mind to the upper realms, rather similar to what we see also in certain Christian meditative mystical reflections on devotion. And that prayer itself becomes transformed, perhaps from a state of supplication or a state of bakasha or even a state of praise to a meditative experience, to a contemplative relationship between the person and divinity, and that the task of the accomplishment, the attainment that we are then trying to reach in tefillah, in this drama of prayer, is actually to attain a mind transformed, to attain a consciousness elevated and lifted up into God's own self. And this is how this particular medieval mystic, Isaac of Akko, offered a kavanah for the beginning of the Amidah. And here I turn our attention to this smaller packet following the enlarged title page from my book. Turn to this page 187. Where Rabbi Yitzchak reflects on that opening line from the Amidah, right? The line from Psalm 51, Adonai Sfatai Tiftach Ufi Yagiti Latecha, and by the way, the Adonai there is the Shem Adnut, is the Aleph Dalet Nun Yud name. It's actually not the Shem Havaya, not the Yud Heh Vav Heh name in the original Psalm. But essentially, right, the way in which this verse is literally understood is, Lord, open my lips that my mouth may speak your praises, right? But what we see in this text is the mystic transforming that particular line into an opening into meditative consciousness. And here, looking at the third line in the Hebrew, and I'll translate, but the translation is also printed here below. Or rather, the second line. I'm sorry. That where he says, "Kvari yadata," you already know. Ki bechol makom shem aleph dalid romez la'atara. That in every place, the name of God that is called the aleph dalid name, that is to say, the shem adnut or Adonai spelled aleph dalid nun yud, hints to Shekhinah, or the lowest of the 10 sefirot within God, or the opening from this world into the divine realm. And he goes on to say here that the process of saying Adonai Svatai Tiftach is not God open my lips so that I can then speak to you, but rather God open the borders for me. Open the gateways to me, to your inner self, so that I can ascend upward into the heavenly realm, so that I can ascend into you, God. And then I will be able to say the first baruch, the first blessing of the first utterance of baruch. Within the first blessing of the Amidah. And once I've ascended upward, then I will be able to draw down your energies, I'll be able to draw down your life force, your Shefa into the world. So the Kabbalist, sort of in brief, already earlier in this classic time of medieval Kabbalah, reimagine the act of prayer as an ascent of the mind, an ascent of consciousness upward into God. The act of prayer and the kavanah of prayer is transformed into a contemplative encounter and a kind of pilgrimage to the upper world. So one could say that the relationship of the medieval Kabbalists, sort of writ large, though here we're specifically talking about one Kabbalist, is to understand the meaning of the words of prayer, to understand the text of the liturgy as a kind of meditative map to the upper world of divinity. And that by entering into those words and letters, I, as a person in prayer, am able to ascend higher and higher, deeper and deeper into God's own self. And conceptions of Kavanah of this sort, of the Kabbalists, became more and more complicated as those generations went on. And it became, there became many more abstract versions of this, many more complicated acrobatics of the mind, but all of it essentially turned on the question of how can I, as a mystic in this world, ascend upward into God? So we kind of fast forward several centuries to how the mysticism of prayer in Kabbalah is transformed into something rather different, and we might say perhaps more applicable and relatable in our day. And that really turns on the figure, the founding figure of Hasidism, of Hasidic mysticism, in the middle of the 18th century, in the first part, and then in the middle of the 1700s in Poland. The figure Rabbi Yisrael ben Eliezer Baal Shem Tov, known simply as the Baal Shem Tov, or as the Besht. So we'll get to the best of the best. I'm sorry, but I couldn't resist that one. The figure who was and continues to be the founding inspiration for a new type of Jewish spirituality, theology, and approach to religious practice and experience. And among his core insights, which are sort of peripheral to what we're going to focus on tonight, among his core insights that were formative for early Hasidism included the idea that God is to be found in all that we experience. Milo kol ha'aretz kevodo, that the fullness of God's glory fills everything, that God is not to be found only in the highest heavens, transcendent and beyond our world, but God is to be found in the depths of the world we encounter and in the depths of the human heart and the human soul. And one of his core teachings really turns the notion of encountering the words of prayer in a very different way. Just to say, as opposed to understanding those words of prayer, like the medieval Kabbalists, as jumping off points to the upper world, as meditative springboards to enter upward into God, he argued that sometimes, he said that sometimes we all feel like it's difficult to pray. Sometimes we all feel far from God in the moment of prayer, and our mind and our soul, our heart, just isn't in it, just isn't there. So what should you do in that kind of a situation when you're feeling that you're in a katnut of mind, right, a katan of mind, you're in this smallness or narrowness of mind, and you're yearning for what he calls the gadlut of mind, the gadol, the greatness, expansiveness of mind, where God shines in like a flashing, like a flashing light, like a lightning rod, that a flash of lightning that illuminates the darkness, but is then retreats back into the darkness. And how do you hold on to that, the memory of that illumination? How do you hold on to that that radiance of God? And he says, when you're feeling far from God in prayer, you should enter with your whole self and your whole mind into the words and the letters of the tefillah, of the liturgy, of the prayers that stand before you, that lie before you. And he does this through an amazing interpretive play on a famous verse from Parshat Noach, in which God instructs Noach to build an ark, to build a teva, and to make a window for the ark. Sohar ta'aseh la teva, make a window for the ark that the light may shine through it, and so on and so forth, right? So building the ark. But what's particularly striking about the way in which the Baal Shem Tov reinterprets this is through a play on the word teva itself. Because in the biblical text, in Parshat Noach, teva means ark. But already in Rabbinic Hebrew, and certainly beyond, teva also means word. So this immediately jumped out to the Baal Shem Tov. He didn't say that. I'm imagining. He as an amazing interpretive springboard to the spiritual imagination. So instead of make a window for the ark, this ark that you're building to save yourself and the animals in your family from the impending flood. Make a window for the word. Sohar ta'aseh lateva. Make a window for the word that the light of God might shine through it and bring you, put you in touch with that radiance of God. Because the Baal Shem Tov taught, God's presence is to be found as radiant light dwelling in those, each and every letter of the Hebrew alphabet, and dwells there as divine presence to be rediscovered. Here he is building upon the classic Agadah found already in rabbinic sources, that when God first set out to create the world and first created light, the primordial first light of creation, the Vayehi Or, that light shone from one end of the earth to the other, Misof HaOlam Ve'ad Sofo. And if you looked into that light, you could see from one end of the earth to the other. But as the Agadah says, as that narrative, as that legend says, God immediately became afraid that the wicked of the world would abuse that light, and decided to hide that light away, letzadikim latid lavo, for the righteous in the time to come. So if you're a good Jewish God, where are you going to hide your precious light? In the Torah, of course, because of course the Torah was already there. No? But this is also an old tradition that the Torah preceded creation, relates to Christian logos theology, that God was God and the Word, and God was the Word that preexisted creation. For now, we'll stick with this particular rendition. The idea is that there was a kind of spiritual thing called Torah, which of course was made up of these primordial Hebrew letters, with which Shamayim va'aretz nivru'u, with which heavens and earth were created. They were the stuff of creation. And they are, in the mystical view, an extension of the very divine self. But God decided in that legend to hide the light in the Torah, and as the tradition unfolded with that, interpreting that legend, in the sacred letters of the Hebrew language, which make up the Torah and which make up the very heart of existence, that the Lashon HaKodesh, that the holy language of Hebrew, is actually the kind of the divine fabric that underlies all of reality. And that light that God put into those letters of the Torah at that beginning moment of time, that primordial moment, stayed there and dwelled there for each person to uncover in their study of Torah and in their prayer and in their encounter with the holy letters in each generation to come. So, this was the tradition that was in the back of the Baal Shem Tov's mind when he said that each of those letters of the Sidur that you're encountering are filled with divine light. We're going to see another passage about this in just a moment. Right, that each of the each of those letters of the liturgy of the Sidur, just like each of the letters that make up the Holy Torah, they contain that essence of divinity, that life force of God that is reflected in the light, or that is embodied in the light. This, by the way, just parenthetically, the idea that God is understood to be a luminous being who gives off light, radiance, and those who stand in the presence of divinity are bask in that light, and they become radiant too, they become enlightened, right? And we find this in a variety of spiritual traditions. In the biblical depiction of Moshe's experiences descending Mount Sinai, as his face radiant with light from the encounter. So the idea is that God is a kind of source of light, a being of light whose encounter with whom is illuminating and is enlightening. And that when we encounter God, we are filled with that light. So when we gaze into the sacred letters of the Torah and the sacred letters of Tefillah, our task is to reach deep meditatively, to reach deep with our most powerful concentration, to unearth those sparks of light of God that dwell there, that have dwelled there since the beginning of time. And as the Baal Shem Tov says, continuing to riff off the verses from Parshat Noach, right, where it says, Bo atav chol betecha el hateva, right? Enter you and your whole household enter into the ark. The Baal Shem Tov says, this is to teach us that you and your whole self should enter into the Word. And enter into the Word with all of your strength, all of your koach, and concentrate on those sparks of light that dwell deep within the letters of the Torah. And concentrate. If you're feeling far from God, all you need to do in that moment, right, when you're sitting there and you're trying to daven and all you can think about is what you're going to do next or what you wish you had done differently or what you're hoping to do tomorrow, that what you should try to bring yourself back to is that each of those letters and words that lie before you on the page of the Siddur are chambers of divine light. And if you look closely, the Baal Shem Tov is going to say in a moment, you will see them sparkling together. And you'll see them joining together even more until they ignite a great flame. And they illuminate you to the point that they ignite the flame of Hitlahavut in your heart. Something perhaps to think about as you're contemplating Biur Chametz this year, right? That the burning up of Chametz is also the burning up of that inner residue blocking us from the light of God, and we need to try to break it open through that flame in the heart to encounter the divine presence. And the Baal Shem Tov says that once you start to see those sparks of light, then you can close your eyes in Kavvanah. Because then you have reached a different place of connection to God in that moment. Let's turn to page 2 of this packet, which expands on this theme. Section Pechet. Yasim kol machshavato machshavato bekoach hatevot shehu medaber. A person should place all of their thought, all of their mind, in the force and the energy of the words that you speak. Ad sheir e haorot shel hatevot, until you see, I'm taking it from the he will to the you, you'll forgive me, until you see the lights of those letters. Ha'ech mitnotzitzim ze baze, how they sparkle one with the other. U'mitocho noldim kama orot, and from that sparkle are born several more lights. And this is the deep mystical meaning of the verse from Psalms, Or Zaru al Tzadik Uli Shrelev Simcha, which by the way is also used in the context of that primordial light, right? That the light is sown, is hidden beneath the surface soil of reality, you might say, for the tzaddik, for the righteous, that they may receive it and benefit from it. Uli Yishrei Lev Simcha, that the righteous upright of heart will rejoice in it. In other words, that light of God has been hidden away beneath the earth of reality, of your perception, until it flowers forth, until the seed flowers forth and reveals itself as the divine presence. Ha'otiyot sheba'Torah, the letters of the Torah that are in the Torah, hem chadarim shel Hashem Yitbarach. The letters of the Torah are the chambers of divinity. They are the rooms that God fills with light. So imagine the letters and the words of the tefillah not just as words that are communicating request, supplication, or praise, but rather as holy dwelling places for that divine presence, which is there to draw you in into the depths of meditative concentration when you feel far from God. And that this moment, the Baal Shem Tov teaches, this moment is a kind of contemplative transformation where we encounter that uplifting and illuminating presence of God, and we're taken, they say, into this place of godlut, of expanded mind, and out of katnut, smallness of mind. And this is a simple practice, the Baal Shem Tov says. It's not the elaborate practice of ascending to the upper worlds. And it's not the practice of each word being a symbol of a different aspect of God as it is in medieval Kabbalah. But it's just being able to open up your eyes to the fact that God fills all of the heavens and all of the earth. That God dwells in the depths of your heart and your soul, and God dwells in those letters and words of Torah. As it says here on page 3 of the packet, section Pei, that the act of Kavvanah, that moment of intention in prayer, should bring you back to the idea, should bring you back to the Kavvanah, that these letters and words were the instruments by which heaven and earth were created, and they are the constant instruments by which God is constantly recreating the world. Yechaven b'tfilah shemeorer otiyot shenivre'u bahem shamayim va'aretz v'chol abruim kulam. Actually, that's the second clause. Right? That you should have the intention in prayer that you are awakening and stirring up the letters with which heaven and earth were created. V'chol abruim kulam elyonim etachtonim kol ha'olamot kulam. Right? That all of these elements of the world are being stirred up and awakened through your prayer. It says on the third line here of this little excerpt, ki hu me'orer ha'otiyot, v'ha'otiyot hem ha'chiyut shel habruim. Because a person is awakening the letters, and the letters are the vitality and the life force of all of the creatures. And elsewhere, the Baal Shem Tov taught that in that moment of Kavvanah, one should try to connect oneself to that life force of God that fills everything, and let that lift you up into meditative connection to God. One of the ways in which the Hasidic masters differed from the earlier Jewish mystics of the Kabbalistic tradition, as we said, was this turn to a kind of simple but inspirational message. right? A turn away from the complex meditative ascents to the upper world into the idea that God is there right in front of you. If only you would learn, if only I would learn how to take my hands away from my eyes. If only I could see that God is right there in front of me. And one of the reflections that is offered is that in the days of old, when there were all these kavanot, all of these intentions, all of these very complicated ways for ascending upwards into God, it was like one had to walk around with a heavy set of keys. And you had 100 different keys, and you had to know which key to take out and which lock to put it in. But he says, in our day, we don't know which key to use. And not only that, but he says that nothing brings a person closer to God than a broken heart, than shivron lev. Here I turn to page 4. The bottom right paragraph, the section bet, the third line. Ulachen inyan tfila tzarich liyot b'shivron lev. So that true prayer has to take place with brokenheartedness. Or perhaps it means a kind of breaking open of the heart. And that only when one has succeeded in breaking open the heart, then will one be able to receive the Divine Presence. And so the Baal Shem Tov said, and the Magid of Mezrich said a different way after him, that instead of using the keys to unlock all of these complex, heavy locks that stand over the gate to heaven, as it were, or the gate to God, the breaking open of the human heart is like taking the sledgehammer to the lock and smashing it open. And that smashing open of the locks, that smashing open of the gates, is what truly brings a person closer to God. Rabbi Nachman of Bratslav, an early 19th century Hasidic mystic, who was the great-grandson, actually, of the Baal Shem Tov, said first that nothing is so whole as a broken heart, but also said that true prayer takes place when a person is able to spontaneously break open the coverings and the walls and the protections that we place over our vulnerabilities, over our hearts, and we are able to speak openly before God. And he spoke about a practice of a very different practice from regular liturgical communal prayer, in particular of the davening of the liturgy with all of its specificity, and spoke of the need for each individual to set aside a time when they will, in a solitary way, break open their heart before God and confess themselves before God, and to pour out all of their yearnings and all of your regrets and all of your hopes and all of your vulnerabilities before God in a way that is a kind of devotional outpouring and yearning that is fundamentally different from this notion of engaging with the text of tefillah. Any initial thoughts about some of that? What do you think about some of these some of these ideas.
Please. On a daily basis, I do have some very specific to come up with, and I know that sometimes, is this term I can get it right, but I have, things open up, and, whatever fears I have, whatever, it's just sort of there. And I do it both in English as well as in Hebrew. I do have six systems every day. But I have this overwhelming sense of peace, and
that's beautiful. I was Yeah, I don't know if I could fully repeat exactly the way you said. Do you want to say it again so other people could hear?
Sure. No, I do every day. I do about six or seven tefillin, and when I really sort of I do about six or seven tefillin a day, and I do in English and Hebrew. And when I really, really open up my heart while I do it, that I end up with this overwhelming sense of peace. It's a very profound experience. And when I'm not quite there, that doesn't happen. So, but in other words, I have this experience.
It's very beautiful, and part of what I was initially thinking about, I would walk around like Phil Donahue, but I got the camera here, so people still know Phil Donahue. I was just recently studying Chaim Nachman Bialik's great poem Habrecha with my students in a class on contemporary Jewish mysticism, thinking about a related kind of question where the poet recalls this moment from his youth, which is kind of building on the romanticism of poets, not directly necessarily poets like Wordsworth and others, who romanticized the wonders of the natural world as a place in which the sacred and the divine becomes manifest. And his experience of wandering in the woods, his memory of this moment when he encountered this illuminating brecha, this illuminating pool in the woods that was kind of like a symbol for the gilui shechina, that was a symbol for the revelation of the divine presence and the indwelling of God. He reports feeling like he was being called, like he was being spoken to and said, Ayeka, right? Where are you? And it was striking to me to think about that, right, in its relationship now to what we're doing in tefillah and kavanat tefillah, and what we're doing in our spiritual practice in general, which needs to incorporate, I think, a kind of self-reflection in which we ask ourselves, Ayeka, right? Or we hear God saying through us, Ayeka, where are you in your life? Where are you in this particular moment? Where are you in this particular moment of your day, right? In relationship to all, to the others with whom you encounter and exist in relationship, and in relation to the world around you and your spiritual life and your moral life, right? That our tefillah, in addition to being that kind of meditative ascent and moment of revelatory illumination that some of these mystics are talking about, that experience can also be resonant with a kind of self-awareness, right? Or should be filled with a process of being in tune with where we are in our moral, spiritual progress and journey through this life.
Perhaps perhaps you could comment on where, I mean, in classical prayer, it's about asking for things. How does that factor into this meditative view of the Kabbalists, especially the Baal Shem Tov?
Yes. Did everyone hear? So the Rabbi Silber was mentioning in classic understandings of prayer, so much of tefillah is about bakasha, right? Is about request or supplication, asking for things, and so forth, right? In addition to, let's say, the hallelujahs of Shabbat and so forth. And where does that fit into all of this, right? Because for the most part, what we're talking about here is a transformation of the literal meaning of the liturgy, the way the mystics understand, the way they try to reimagine literal and figurative or symbolic meaning in every Jewish text, such that the literal meaning of the Torah is understood to be just the first garment layer for the deepest truth of what the Torah is really about. That the Torah is not what it seems to be at first glance, at the pshat, simple meaning, but is actually a deep roadmap, the mystics would say, into the mystery of the divine self and into the mystery of our own spiritual hearts. And so too is the text of Tefillah, in that even where it seems like the text is telling us something at the literal level, or we're asking for something at the literal level, or the blessing, the bracha, is talking about a particular request or a particular praise. In addition to that first level, that pshat level, because they wouldn't necessarily obliterate that, although in some cases they would, what they believed to be the deeper purpose was to bring us closer to an unmediated connection to divinity. One later Hasidic master, the Slonim Rebbe, author of the Netivot Shalom, the late 20th century Hasidic master, said that all of the mitzvot, and here he was building on earlier tradition as well, all of the mitzvot are pieces of advice, you might say, on how to come closer to God. And he takes it even further to say that all of the mitzvot are actually pathways to dveikut, pathways to binding oneself with complete unity and bondedness to God. That the whole purpose of the life of the mitzvot, and Allah hakama v'kama, so almost how much the more so prayer, which is so much about that devotional encounter with God, that all of those mitzvot are aimed at this ultimate purpose of bringing us heart to heart, or bringing our hearts to God, right? And bringing us into a state of, the mystics would say, of complete unity, where we are like the water in the pitcher that is poured into the flowing stream of the river of divinity. And you might say, well, what happened to my selfhood in that image? And that is kind of a dilemma for the mystics, right? Mystics across religious boundaries speak about that moment of a kind of ecstatic union with God, like an overflowing where the self essentially melts into God. So where does that leave the classic model of petition, of bakasha? I would say that if we pushed them on it, because usually they just try to bypass it and go straight to this stuff, if we pushed them on it, they would not reject the idea that that's there, but they would say that that's only the first layer of the meaning of the text, and that our deeper purpose is to enter into God through it. That said, the Kabbalists in particular believed that their actions in the realm of the mitzvot in particular, with the right kind of kavanah, actually had the power to affect God in a deep and transformative way, and something that's actually quite bold and radical, especially in contrast to Maimonides' classic belief that God is completely transcendent and totally immune to any actions on the part of the human being. The mystics believed that everything that we do in this world, and all the more so in the realm of the mitzvot, has a triggering, powerful effect upon God, that when we sin or are unethical in this world, we create ruptures and brokenness within the very self of divinity. And it then becomes our responsibility to effect a tikkun. This is where the idea of tikkun comes from, in tikkun olam and so forth. It's really filtered through Kabbalistic language. We then have this responsibility to effect a kind of redemptive repair and fixing of God's self. And the act of tefillah, the process of tefillah, becomes kind of paradigmatic, becomes one of the most powerful examples of in the life of mitzvot, where kavanah, where specific kinds of mental focusing are brought to bear on those actions, such that they were believed by the Kabbalists to facilitate the overflow of the divine energies, that chiyut, that life force of all being that is God, which flows forth, the mystics say, like the stream flows forth from the deepest hidden mountain spring and rushes down the mountains and merges into all the waters of the world, that flowing force of water is a symbol for the divine self and for the divine circulation through the body of being. And that our task as spiritual people, as people who have spiritual eyes in their head, the mystics would say, who have learned how to see with the eyes of clarified spiritual sight, that we're able to see the way in which God is truly present right before us. But it also teaches us that our actions matter deeply, and that there are ripple effects. I first saw a hand in the back there, please.
So just going back to the concept of heartbreak in terms of...
Yes. I'm sorry, can everyone hear? I can hear, but I just want to make sure. Can everyone hear?
Yeah.
Yes? Yeah. Mm-hmm. All right, well, since you're in the back, you're reaching forward. The coal is...
Exactly. And so that sort of introduces a really paradoxical element to it, because if, as in Yiddish, Nefesh, we're trying to be most heartbreaking thing we can experience is understanding how distant, in fact, we are from God, then in order to get...
Mm.
Are you following what I'm saying?
Yeah. Yeah, very, very nice. And that the Yiddi Nefesh, which is actually a Kabbalistic poem, which was incorporated into the liturgy after 16th century Tzfat, really does reflect that kind of ebb and flow of the devotional relationship and the way in which the soul is sick with love for God, in the sense that there is a kind of sense of divine absence that is actually the most palpable presence that you could ever imagine, and that it stirs up the pangs of longing for God. Along the lines of Shir HaShirim and all the ways it's been reinterpreted. Rabbi Nachman, in the passage that I was alluding to, and actually it's found toward the end of this packet as well. I won't read it in full, but it's cited here as prayer in the vernacular on the last page of this packet. Which essentially says that in that practice of what he calls hitbodedut, or in seclusion, breaking open your heart and pouring your emotions out to God, sometimes you are going to just be aware of the fact that you feel far from God, and just be aware that you have nothing to say to God. And what's really quite powerful about the way Rabbi Nachman handles that is he says, then that too is a good thing, and that should become the subject of your prayer. That bring to consciousness, bring to attention, this fact that you feel far from God, you feel alienated from the divine presence, and you feel alienated from the sacred in your life. Understands that way back is actually through that breaking open of the heart. It's almost like we protect our hearts with so many barbs and so many walls, right? And part of the process of self-discovery and part of the process of wholeness is learning how to open those up and how to become vulnerable and both with other people and also before the spiritual life. One might say that the act of true prayer becomes one of being able to stand before God with an open heart, and not feel dominated by all those all too human feelings of, do I look silly? Am I davening with great kavvanah right now? I wish I had done X, Y, and Z an hour ago, right? So in other words, am I really able to stand, be in the present moment, the Hasidic masters would say, and Martin Buber would say, interpreting them, be in the present moment and open my heart to God. Please. Yes. No, it's a great question. Yeah. No, it's a great question, and the effect, at least the way the mystics perceive this, the effect of our actions is actually so powerful that we sometimes create separations within God's own self. And that it's then incumbent upon us to bring that separation back into wholeness, right? It's kind of startling because we're used to thinking about God as this immutable, unchangeable perfection, right? And part of what's so bold about the mystical view is actually saying that God's self too can be vulnerable to breaking and can be vulnerable to brokenness. Perhaps one of the very powerful adaptations of this is to say that when we encounter brokenness in the world and when we encounter brokenness in ourselves, that too is a kind of reflection of a divine brokenness. As the mystics would say, Alma tata kegavna de alma de la'ela, the world below this world exists on the model of the world on high, of the divine world. And so everything that we encounter in this world, in the things that we see in this world, in our experience of the mitzvot and of prayer, that these are lower reflections, you might say, of the deeper mystery of God. So when I act in a wrong way, or when I do something I regret, and I try to do tikkun for it, when I try to do a repair for it, the mystics would say that is not only a tikkun in this world, but it's also affecting a tikkun in the divine realm as well. What other hitorerut is out there? How do you feel? How do you feel you might imagine some of these practices finding their way into your own spiritual lives of prayer? Can you imagine thinking about the Tzohar Ta'asela Teva the next time you're feeling far from God? Maybe contemplating that radiant light of divinity while you reconnect through a powerful nigun. Yes.
I'd like to ask, actually not respond to that, but ask a question.
Sure.
So you've laid out two approaches: the transcendent ascent approach, and the immanent theology, so the immanent ecstatic theology. I'm interested in what we might call sort of taxonomy of mystical diagnostics. So we have, for example, here, I was looking at some things from your book, you shall immediately enter into a straight path or your properly directed thought, hara to the central line, so I'm just quoting from your text here. We know now as well as then that there were rabbis who had deep sight and could see. What sort of extant materials do we have with regard to being able to offer correctives? I mean, these are very image oriented, but rabbis who could see how you were moving through this field and would be able to say things like, you know, change your breathing here, or you've gone to this like course correction, you know, what sort of materials would, you know, change your breathing, change your posture, sit here, slow down here? I mean, what sort of extant materials do you need?
So I wish that we had those kind of materials from this period, though there are some interesting materials along those lines from the 16th century, from the circle of Isaac Luria, the Ari, who was known as a kind of charismatic Kabbalistic healer, as one who was a clairvoyant, who was able to both see into the future and see into the depths of the human soul and heart, or at least was perceived to be able to do that. Certainly convinced a lot of people, right? And a lot of the literature surrounding the Ari actually was that he was a holy man who was able to gaze into a person in the way that they described it. He would be able to gaze on their palms or in their forehead, we know of that kind of practice from other religious traditions as well, envisioning configurations of Hebrew letters on their foreheads and on their palms, and thereby understand what their problem was in their religious moral life and what their process of tikkun was. And we know of certain kinds of healer practices, or what has been described as physicians of the soul, in a variety of religious traditions. So the best example of that we have in the Kabbalistic tradition is certainly that surrounding Isaac Luria and the Ari. And then there were other figures like the Baal Shem Tov, who were also healer figures. So along this line of the mystic as a healer figure, became a recurrent trope and recurrent theme, where you had figures who were both understood to be great teachers of mystical secrets, were also believed to have healing powers, both at the physical and the spiritual and psychological levels. And in the case of the Baal Shem Tov, he was called the Baal Shem Tov not because he had a good reputation, but because he was master of the divine name. So he was able to utilize divine names in amulet making, in healing practices, these were quite widespread beliefs in among folk traditions, and and the elite, so-called elite of Eastern Europe, our holy ancestors.
I wanted to ask a question building on the last, which is, are there any words that you see about the problems, the potential problems in a deeply individualistic practice, that is to say, conducted outside of your, outside the, without the supervision of not knowing thoughts? I think he assumed that we would have some sort of level of spiritual supervision. It wasn't a totally individualistic practice. Is that not right?
It's a. Did everyone hear?
No.
So the question was. This tension between, was this practice that Rabbi Nachman of Bratslav was advocating for, which by the way is still practiced by contemporary Bratslav Hasidim, was that a completely individualistic practice? As to, was there any supervision? Was there any relationship to the community?
Or a discussion of potential problems in a very individualistic practice?
Yes. Were there problems with that individualistic practice, in relationship to communal norms and that kind of thing, perhaps, or not? So I guess what I would say, Bekitsur, is in brief, I would say that in the Bratslav community where this emerged from the teaching of Nachman was. It was already the norm, right? That people were davening three times a day, usually in a minyan, right? So that was sort of taken for granted. So this was in addition to that, and usually, according to the teachings they found in Likutei Moharan, in the collected teachings of Rabbi Nachman, he stipulates that ideally this should be done in the dead of night, on a lone path in the middle of the woods, which doesn't sound like a very safe place to be in Ukraine. One of my students said last semester, it's like, it's not so much better to go to Central Park, right, do that. I guess if you have enough of them going around and, just call to me, hey, Shlomi, I'm over here. No. So the idea was that one would find true seclusion, right? And he would say, if you couldn't do that, then shut yourself up in a secluded room. But the importance of the solitary nature of it was emphasized because the practice became one of total release, where it was almost like a kind of precursor to the catharsis of psychoanalysis, you might even say, right? In the sense that there was a kind of encouragement to weep and to wail and to open up one's deepest emotions, and it was very self-consciously stated in the literature that one would be very reluctant to do that if one was being watched by another person.
I don't mean being watched, people have various levels of psychological balance today and then, right? And so, I'm just curious.
Right. So the degree to which did people need some kind of check-in with a spiritual master, a spiritual mentor? I think that is very important. And certainly in the generation of Rabbi Nachman, though he became right the departed master who continued to be the master, right? Sort of forecasting to some extent what happened with the last Lubavitcher Rebbe, right? So Rabbi Nachman, who died in 1810, remained and remains the Rebbe of Bratslav even to this day, right? So even those who have carried on the tradition of Bratslav are not the Rebbe, right? Whereas other traditions became more dynastic in that way, but certainly in his day and in subsequent generations, in different ways, there were mechanisms like that of the intense relationship between the disciple, the chassid, and the master, the rebbe. Please.
But that practice, was that in service of catharsis as the end result, or was that in service of achieving the shivrun lev or something? Right.
Yes.
That's a method for getting to that place.
Right.
You remove community, you remove the protections in service of finding the brokenness and fixing the right? Like Eliezer Berkowitz says something to that effect as well about prayer is a cry, right? That's the essence of it. And I've always thought that that's in service ultimately of in that way, bringing you closer to an awareness of a dependency and a vulnerability that puts you in relation to God, in a more dependent position. It feels very, so I wonder if that understanding, as opposed to catharsis itself, is accurate.
Yes, you're absolutely right. They would not have, Rabbi Nachman and before him the Baal Shem Tov, who said this other thing, wouldn't have framed it in that kind of terminology. I was sort of thinking about it, kind of, you know, in relation to other 19th century development and then later. But yes, I think you're absolutely right that the core issue here, I know we're down to our final minutes. The core issue that you're raising, which is very important, is that other significant element of what's represented in Hit Bo Dedut and what's represented in that model is that just like we already see in the older tradition, right, that all of the gates might be locked, but the gate of tears is opened, right? In other words, that there's a kind of there's kind of an opening when you open yourself, as it were, right? And in this case, the Shivron Lev, perhaps brokenheartedness evokes too much in the sense of sadness and despair in our language, right? And I think that it definitely evokes that as well in this language too. But it's also kind of smashing open, as it were, like this image of not fumbling for the keys but smashing open the locks. It's like sometimes what you don't need are meditative methods. What you need is just emotional fullness or emotional openness, release, a breaking open of the heart, and in this case, a kind of shivron of all the ways in which we keep our hearts locked. So I guess what I would say in conclusion is that my prayer for all of us, for you, for me, is as we journey toward Pesach, and as we think about the relationship of our own individual process of moving to liberation each year, mechadash, and connecting to that great moment in the past, that we also become awakened to the ways in which our heart needs to be opened in a new way in this season, in the way in which we can open our hearts to be a little bit more vulnerable, a little bit more loving, a little bit more spiritually attentive than we might have been before.
So. I'd like to thank Professor Fishbane for, I think, raising a host of very important questions, both in terms of what prayer is, and actually the practice would be a very interesting thing to pursue. And also mentioning Rav Nachman many times, who's a total goldmine when it comes to these things. Next week, something completely different. We have with us Dr. David Schatz, and we'll talk about Rabbi Soloveitchik and other recent thinkers of the 20th century and their approach towards prayer. I want to remind everyone, thank you for coming. Again, we have the workshops, which are about the practice, and then the what are we doing, which are the lectures. And next week, we complete the series after Pesach. We are having a three-part series on three Wednesday nights confronting mental illness. It's in conjunction with B'nai Yeshua and with DJ, and I think it's a very important topic to bring to the community, and it should be, we work very hard to play this thing together. I think it's both important and should be extremely interesting. Next week is Dr. Schatz. Thank you very much.